Welcome to the first lecture of the machine learning course. Our plan for today is this. I will, if you're interested in the details of the course, the administrative stuff, what you have to do, how to get, what the practicalities are, I will come to that. Sort of halfway through part two. So don't worry, I'm going to go into that and I'm going to explain it in detail. But just for the sake of the latecomers, I will start with the subject matter and save that for later. So this is our outline for today. As you may expect, I'm going to start by telling you what machine learning is. So let's put this on the board. That shouldn't take too long. Then we're going to go into some of the tasks that we can solve with machine learning and the role that tasks play in machine learning, which is very crucial. These come in two flavors. Supervised. Then there's a break. Then we deal with the unsupervised models. Then I would like to discuss briefly what machine learning isn't. By which I mean I'd like to set it apart from other disciplines that are very similar but slightly different to give you a proper bearing on what exactly machine learning is. Machine learning versus other disciplines. And then I'm going to tell you what you're going to do in the course, hopefully, and what I'm going to tell you about in the rest of the course. For now, let's start with the obvious. What is machine learning? And to start with, very briefly, I'm going to take a bit of a step back in time as well as in subject, and approach it from a philosophical angle. This is a statue of David Hume, quite a flattering statue of David Hume, a philosopher from the 18th century, who is probably most famous for discussing the problem of induction, which is this problem. Basically, we have deductive reasoning, which is something like this: all men are mortal, Socrates is a man, therefore Socrates is immortal. This sort of reasoning that the classical philosophers were very very excited about and studied for a long time. And what Hume did and others did is they contrasted this with what they call inductive reasoning, where it's not quite so clear, and it's not quite clear that the consequence follows from the setup, but you still, like in inductive reasoning, you are given some information and you create, your brain creates new knowledge out of this information. In this case, we have observed the sun has risen in the east every day of my life, so tomorrow the sun will rise and it will rise in the east again. That is knowledge. We observe a lot of things happening and we think, well, it will probably happen again. And as with all philosophical questions, this is either really obvious and you don't see what the point is, or this is a really deep question. It's up to you. But note that this is, it's not quite clear that this type of thing always happens. For instance, I've been to a few funerals in my life, and every time I've been to a funeral, I'm not the person in the box. So the next time I go to a funeral, I won't be the person in the box. And the more funerals I see, the more certain I will be that the next time I will not be the person in the box. So when I'm 99, I will be super certain that the next funeral, I will not be the person in the box. Quick question?
It's funny that you should mention this because there's this other philosopher who says that if you die, you don't attend your funeral. You exactly your funeral, therefore it's still
okay, that's very, that's an interesting point. Another philosopher, I don't know his name, said that if you die, you don't attend your funeral. I would like to stay away from the from going too deeply into the philosophical side of things. The only point I'm trying to make here is that this is the way computers reason. Oh, yeah, sorry, one more point. So what Hume said was deductive reasoning is basically impossible to figure out how we do this from deductive reasoning. You cannot prove that this conclusion is valid or when such conclusions are valid using deductive reasoning. It's not a special case of deductive reasoning, it's something entirely other, and we're not quite sure how we do it and how it works. Whereas here, we know exactly how it works and we know exactly how we do it. And this is basically how computers work, right? They follow rules, they are discrete, and the rules always hold and the computers always follow the rules. And this is how we work. So if we want to get the computer to do this, we face the same problem that Hume faced. How do we explain how we do this in such rules, in the language of computers, in strict rules? That's machine learning from a philosophical point of view. Zooming in a little bit more, here is a broad definition of machine learning. It provides systems the ability to automatically learn and improve from experience without being explicitly programmed. So I've highlighted systems, first of all, because it's, well, there are computers, we have to do this on a computer. I've highlighted experience because we are trying to make programs that experience the world and that store those experiences and somehow use them. And they use them to do things that we haven't explicitly programmed. And that's very crucial to what machine learning is. It helps us do things for which we don't know the rules, like this inductive problem of induction. If we don't know the rules, if we don't know how to solve a certain task, for instance, recognizing whether a certain picture contains a bird, we don't know how we do that. We know it can be done. We all can all do that quite easily. But we don't quite know what the rules are and how to write down those rules in a computer program. So the machine learning solution is, instead of figuring out what the rules are, why don't we just give the machine learning program lots of examples and maybe it can figure it out for us. This kind of definition sort of implies an agent-based view, where your machine learning system is an agent. Like, we are agents, we experience the world all the time, and we infer stuff from it, and we learn from it. And we update our mental models, and then we keep learning, and we keep interacting, this kind of online feedback loop. That's usually not how machine learning works. Machine learning is usually, it deals with offline learning, which has nothing to do with online and offline on the internet. It means that basically you train your model once, so you have a data set, you train a model on it, and then you're done. Then your machine learning is done, and your model is what you get out of it, and you use your model. You don't have this feedback loop. You train once, and then you're done. Which is a little bit more boring, but it's still very useful. And the idea is that if you can do this, if you can look at this data, so you can look at the experiences of the agent, as it were, you can look at your past data and create a good model and show that that model works well, then the problem of putting that process into an agent and making it update continuously, stuff like that, that's all relatively easy to solve. So we're reducing it to the hard part, making everything else a bit simpler. Let me summarize very quickly what makes a good machine learning problem, which problem should we are good candidates for machine learning? Well, first of all, we can solve it explicitly. So if you want to sort a list of numbers, then you just use a sorting algorithm because we know how to do that. You need a solution where approximate solutions are fine. You need a situation where approximate solutions are fine. Because machine learning algorithms are almost never 100% accurate. So if you want something that detects birds in pictures, and it's fine if it gets 5% of them wrong, you can sort of deal with that in some way or manage that in the rest of your system, then machine learning is appropriate. And you need usually lots of examples. So you need lots of examples of how you want the system to behave, but you can't tell it explicitly how to behave. That's basically machine learning in a nutshell. One example, recommender systems. This is what Netflix used to look like very, very long ago. So imagine you have a bunch of users, and you have a bunch of movies, and the users have, some of the users have told you for some of the movies whether or not they like them, or even how much they like them. Then the question is, can you tell one of these users, on the basis of her past ratings, what other movies in our catalog she might like? And in this case, we have lots of examples. If the user has been active and has rated stuff, we don't quite know how to implement this. We don't know what kind of rules people use to like movies, but they do. And we can set the system up in such a way that it's not too horrible if we get it wrong once in a while. So if Netflix recommends you a movie and you don't like it, you know, you wasted an hour, but people are in general fine, and people in general prefer a system that gets it wrong some of the time to a system that doesn't work, to no system at all. I have a little movie to illustrate how machine learning works. Some of you, and this goes for the entirety of the first lecture, some of you will have seen this before if you've taken intelligent systems. My apologies, after the second lecture everything will be more or less new.
In the 1950s and 60s, scientists built a few working perceptrons, as these artificial brains were called.
He's using it to explore the mysterious problem of how the brain learns.
This perceptron is being trained to recognize the difference between males and females. It is something that all of us can do easily, but few of us can explain how. To get a computer to do this would involve working out many complex rules about faces and writing a computer program. But this perceptron was simply given lots and lots of examples, including some with unusual hairstyles.
But when it comes to a beetle, the computer looks at facial features and hair outline and takes longer to learn what it's told by Dr. Taylor. Andrew Cruikshank's wig also causes a little heart searching.
After training on lots of examples, it's given new faces it has never seen and is able to successfully distinguish male from female. It has learned. While promising, this approach to machine intelligence virtually died out.
What this illustrates is a very fundamental idea of machine learning, which is that we don't want to solve each problem in isolation. So here are some problems that we might be able to solve with machine learning that fit these criteria I talked about earlier, like playing chess or driving a car. All problems where we can deal with a system that doesn't quite get it right all of the time, but it can still be useful. But we don't want to solve these problems in isolation. We don't want to just solve playing chess and then go, well, we've solved chess, what's the next problem? Let's start again from scratch. We want reusable components. We want to solve chess in a way that allows us to translate it directly to driving a car. And in order to do that, we abstract away the problem. We abstract away the details of this problem. We abstract away things like chess and driving and terrorists and movie recommendation into abstract tasks with names like classification, regression, clustering, density estimation, etc. I'll show you in a minute what these abstract classes look like, tasks look like. So this is the side of practitioners, people with real-world problems, and then on the side of the researchers, people with problem-solving skills who can make these things, who can make machine learning stuff. They can build algorithms not to solve playing chess, but to solve classification, to solve regression, and solve clustering. And that way, we can work on more reusable machine learning tools. So let's start with classification. Let's have classification and regression, which are supervised tasks. So just to keep you up to date, this is where we are. This is what I meant by tasks and models and why it's so important. And now we're going to look at classification. And the way we've abstracted the way we abstract problems is first by translating it into a data set. And the data set consists of instances, which are examples of the things we're trying to learn about, like emails in this case. A target value, the thing that we're trying to learn about the instance, about the example, in this case, whether or not it's spam, whether it's spam or ham. And then features. And features are the things we've measured about the examples. So in the case of emails, we might measure whether certain words appear in the email or not, or even how often a certain word appears in the email. So that's our data set. This is what we're going to feed to a learner. And this is a black box. This is a black box that has to be filled in by a specific choice of algorithm. And what we want that algorithm to do is to produce a model. And when we're doing classification, which means that the target values are categorical values, so they're a choice of a small number of values, in this case two possible values. Then we have a classifier, so the learner produces a model, which we call a classifier. And then if we, and the model is a function from the features to the class. So if we get a new email, we extract the features, we count how much the first word occurs, how much the second word occurs, and then we ask the classifier what's the class, and the classifier tells us spam, in this case. And it can be either right or wrong. You know, it doesn't have to be wrong 100% of the time. But that's the basic idea. We do this once, we feed it the data set once, and then we get a model, and then that's it. We're done, because it's offline learning. So let's look at a few examples of real-world problems and how they can be abstracted to the task of classification. First up, handwriting recognition is one of these typical machine learning problems. This is a small selection of a very famous data set of handwritten digits. So it's not full handwriting recognition, but it's recognition of handwritten digits. These are all number two. And each digit in the data set comes in a small black and white pixel, small black and white picture of 28 by 28 pixels. Like these. And here it's very simple. We can extract as features, simply make each pixel a feature. So we get 784 features, each between 0 for black and 1 for white. We pass this, and the target classes are the 10 possible digits. We pass that to a learner, the learner produces a classifier, we pass it a new picture, we extract the features, which is just a long row of pixel values, and then it produces for us a classification. That's very simple. Sometimes it's not so simple. Let's look at chess again. The first thing to say about chess is that it's not really, you can't solve the whole problem of chess as a machine learning problem. What you can do in these cases is abstract away part of the problem and see if machine learning can help you there. For instance, we can try and learn a machine learning model, a classifier, that predicts for us, based on some features, whether or not black or white is going to win. And we can get some labeled data for that by just looking at a big database of chess matches, and for every position, labeling that position with the person who eventually won that historical match. The difficult question here is, what are we going to use as features? So a few obvious choices. You could count, for instance, how many black pieces are still remaining on the board, how many white pieces. That has some predictive value. If all the black pieces are still there and there's one white piece left, then black is probably going to win. But it's quite shallow. You can also ask a domain expert to check for things, to tell you things that chess experts check for. Things like, are there passed pawns? Is there a rook behind an open file? Stuff like that. So then you can get more informative, better features. There's no obvious way to take all the information on a chessboard and translate it into a long list of features like we saw in the previous example. And this doesn't solve for you the whole problem. This is not a chess playing engine. This doesn't solve for you the whole problem of playing chess. If you're familiar with the Minimax algorithm, you can basically plug this in as a heuristic, as lots of you did basically last year in intelligent systems. You can plug this in as a heuristic and help it to build, and it will help you to build a chess playing engine. Last example, the self-driving car. This is a historical example, a system called Alvin. Basically what they did is they hooked a black and white camera up to a vehicle, up to a car, filmed the road like this. Very low resolution camera, 30 by 32 pixels. And like in the digit example, they simply took every pixel as a feature and labeled it with the actions observed from human driver. And in reality, they had more than three actions, but it's basically a classification task. And this way, and again, you're solving part of the problem, but you're solving the important part of the problem. The classifier that they learned, they actually used to drive coast to coast in America. So it was good enough to help them drive coast to coast. They did that like this. So the laptop told them what to do, and then they did it, just to be safe. So they didn't drive a fully autonomous car. But at least they say they didn't have to overrule the computer. So that's the problem side, how to abstract a real-world problem to a machine learning task. Of course, the next question is, how, once you've done that, how do you solve that? How do these learners and these classifiers actually work? So to explain that, here is a simple data set where our examples are human beings, specifically US soldiers. And the things we measure about our examples are literally things we measure in this case. We measure the height and we measure the distance between the shoulder blades. And then we label it with whether it's a male or a female. And the nice thing about having two features, just two usually you have much more than two features, but if you have just two features, you can plot this. You plot this on the x-axis and this on the y-axis. You get a nice point cloud, which is colored with your classes. So the idea of classification, visually, is just to take a picture like this, to somehow segment it into a red region and a blue region. And in the red region, you're going to call everything that's in the red region male, and everything that's in the blue region, you're going to call female. First example, simple way to do it is just to draw a line. And that looks like this. And already you see that it's doing pretty well. Some men are misclassified as women, and some women are misclassified as men. But in general, most of the blue points are in the blue area, and most of the red points are in the red area. And if you now see a new person, and you measure that person, and you say, the person is this tall, and has this much distance between their shoulder blades, then it's in the blue area, so I'm going to classify that person as male. Of course, drawing a line only works if you have two features. To generalize to more features, you always have to generalize to an arbitrary number of features. So in one if you have one feature in one dimension, that would just be drawing a dot, and above the dot is one class, and below the dot is the other class. In 3D, it would be a plane. To cut your space into two points, so if you have three features, you need a plane. If you have four or more features, you need what we call a hyperplane. And it's very difficult to draw, but the mathematics are very simple. So we come to that later in the course. One more visualization exercise to answer the question, which line should we pick? We have two lines here, the line I showed you earlier, which was pretty good, and another line, which is terrible. This line doesn't solve the problem for us at all. So which of those two is better? We can visualize this in what we call the model space. So each of these lines is defined by two points, S and B. So we can make S one axis and B one other axis. And then in this space, every point is a potential model. It's what we call the model space. This is the feature space, this is the model space. And what we can do is we can judge every point in this model space, every model, every potential model, by a loss function. And the loss function simply says, for this model, for this parameter, for this particular model, we express the performance of the model on the data. and it's the lower the better. It's an arbitrary choice, but it's the lower the loss, the better. That's how we express our loss function. So the number of misclassified examples, if we're doing classification, that could be a loss function. And once we have a loss function, we can color every point in our model space with that loss function. So the bright points are the points where we have very low loss, and the dark points are the points where we have very high loss. And then this is our best model. This is where we want to end up. And classification basically becomes a search problem. So in this space, we want to search for the point with the lowest loss. And of course, we can only visualize it this nicely because we have such a simple model with only two parameters. In general, you don't get a visualization like this. So it's much more difficult. But this is the principle. Let's look at a radically different type of model, the decision tree classifier. Basically, what a decision tree does is in this case, a binary tree. And at every node, it looks at one particular feature. So at the top node here, it looks at the feature height. And it splits the model space into two regions, whether the height is higher than 163 or lower than 163. So here, this region above and this region below. And then based on that choice, you go to another node, an internal node, which looks at a different feature. In this case, the only other feature we have. Looks at the distance between the shoulder blades. And if you're in this region, it splits it on 46. If you're in this region, it splits it on 42.4. And that gives you this kind of decision boundary, which is always sort of piecewise aligned with the axis. And this can go on for as long as you like. You can add as many nodes as you like, or as little few nodes as you like. The model space is the space of all possible trees with all possible thresholds on the nodes. So it's very difficult to visualize. It's not a nice model space in the plane like I showed earlier. And these trees can get much bigger than this. Just for instance, when I tried the default algorithm with the default settings in SKLearn on this data set, I got this as a classification. Which, in some sense, does pretty well, because it catches all the blue dots in a blue region and all the red dots in a red region. But it might still not be what you want. I'll come back to that later. Final example of a classifier. K-nearest neighbors is very lazy. It's what we call a lazy classifier. It doesn't do any learning on the data. It doesn't build a model. It just remembers the data. And when it sees a new point, it looks at the K, in this case 7, nearest points to that point, and it just takes a majority vote. So there are more blue points next to this point than red points, so we color the point blue, which leads to this kind of decision boundary. I've colored the point I showed earlier. As you can see, it's kind of an in-between between the decision tree classifier and the linear one, so it's got it's a bit more shapely. But also not quite as detailed as the decision tree classifier. This is a binary classification task, so there's a few variations. It's not quite a pure abstract single notion, single task. There are a few different ways of doing it, a few variations you can have. Firstly, I showed you numerical features. You can also have categorical features. You can also have true/false, or gender, or province, or something like that. This is binary classification, which is the nicest setting. Sometimes you have more than two classes, and you get multi-class classification. And quite a few classifiers don't work naturally on more than two classes. Some do, some don't. But like the linear classifier, a line can cut your space into two pieces. But you linearly cut your space into three subspaces is much more difficult to do. So then you need clever tricks to make a binary classifier into a multi-class classifier. Multi-label classification is a setting where multiple labels can be true. So something like determining the category of a book, of a work of fiction, the genre of a work of fiction, multiple things can apply. And that gets very complicated very quickly. So the good news is we won't be going into that in this course. And then sometimes it's nice if your classifier doesn't just give you one class judgment, but if it tells you the probabilities for each class. So it can say, I'm absolutely certain this is spam, or I think it's probably spam, but it's like 40-60, so you might want to take this with a pinch of salt. That can be very useful downstream. We'll look at that next week. Next up, regression. I'm going to go through this quite quickly, I think. So it's very simple. Regression is very similar to classification, except our target value now is not a class, but a number. So we still have a data set with features and instances. We feed it to a learner, we get a model out of it, but the model gives us a number instead of a class. That's all. We are trying to learn a function from our feature space to a numeric value. Here is another example data set. Different measurements this time, so we measure the height again, but we try and predict the length of the legs, which is interesting because it's usually about halfway down the body, but it might differ per person how tall their legs are proportionally to the rest of their body. So if we plot this data set, it looks a bit like this, as we expect, so we get about we get a straight line, but it's a little bit noisy, so some people have very long legs proportionally and some people have very short legs proportionally. And even though this looks a lot like the previous plot, it's important to recognize that it's actually quite different, because we've not plotted the feature space here. We've plotted the feature space. We have only one feature, so our feature space is a line. We've plotted the feature space against the output space. The output is the number that we're trying to predict. In classification, our output space is the set of all classes. Here is the number we're trying to predict. So the same tricks we tried for classification apply here as well. So we can do linear regression. So we draw a line through these points, not a very good line in this case. And then we see we measure a new person, this is their height. And we follow these arrows and say, well, this is what we predict for the height of their legs. Before we start looking at the regression models, let's look at the loss function. So given a particular model, how do we tell how good it is? The most common loss function probably is called the mean squared errors. So if we have some line and these are our points, we just measure the distance to the line, to the prediction of the model. So this is the distance between what the model predicts and what the data actually says. We take all of those distances, all of those errors, we square them. Any idea why we want to square them?
So they're all positive.
So they're all positive, yes. So if we sum these up, if we sum all these blue bits up, we get some positive, some negative. We get a big positive and a big negative, they might cancel out, and we get a loss of zero, even though we have two big errors. But the most important reason we square here is to make all of these positive, sum them up, and then usually divide them by the size of the data set to make them, to average them. And that's our loss function. The bigger this is, the worse our model is. You can think of these things as little rubber bands that you tie to your data and to the model, and each rubber band pulls your model into place. So now that we have a loss function, we can look for the line that gives us the lowest loss. We'll look at how that works tomorrow, on Thursday. But this is the line that we get. That's pretty nice. But we do get quite big residuals. We can also use the tree principle to create what's called a regression tree. So we split this space at some threshold into two. and then into two again. Each section you get restricted into two again and again and again and again, until we get a big tree with some leaves, and then at each leaf we provide an output. And that looks like this. So behind this is a huge tree that has segmented this space into lots of little sections, and it's given each section an output, and as you can see, it fits the data, like the other one, it fits the data very well. Almost all of the data points are exactly captured by one of these, by part of this line. We can also do k-nearest neighbor regression, where basically if you get a new point, you just look at the nearby people here. If you get a new point, you just look at the 6 or 7 points that are close by, and you average their value or you take a majority vote. If you do that, it looks like this. And as you can see, it's again a sort of midpoint between the linear and the regression tree. So I've given you sort of a basic taxonomy. So we have supervised and unsupervised methods. Unsupervised we talk about after the break. We have classification and regression. In the book by Peter Flack, there are a few more ways to think about models, to distinguish models from each other. He talks about grouping versus grading models, geometric, logical, predictive. Well, he explains it very well, so I won't explain it again. Just to summarize what we've been talking about, this is the basic recipe of machine learning. If you want to do machine learning, this is basically, in its simplest form, this is what you're doing. So you take your problem that you want to solve, you abstract it to a standard task, like classification, regression, clustering, density estimation. You do this abstraction by choosing instances and their features, and a target sometimes. Then you pick your model class. We've seen a couple of these, linear models, decision trees, k-nearest neighbors. And then you search for a good model. Or sometimes you don't have to search, like with k-nearest neighbors. But in some sense, you find a good model, and then you're done. That's machine learning. That's all you need to do. So you might ask, why do we have to spend 7 weeks talking about this? Because the definition of a good model is slightly more subtle than I've made it look. Let's look again at the regression, the decision tree and the regression tree. So if we look at the training data, this is a very good model, right? It classifies the training data perfectly, and it hits almost all the points in the training data and the regression example. So would you use this model? Would you prefer this model over the linear classifier, or the linear regression? If I measure a person whose height is this, the regression tree says is the length of the leg should be 95, because it's the one person whose legs are also 95. Is this a natural model? Is this a natural model for the distribution of the feature space of these points? I would say no. I would say it's what we call overfitting. It's doing what we call overfitting. It's memorized the training data. But the classifications we get on the basis of those memorizations, they don't generalize to new data. So if we see a new point here, for instance, here in the classification example, if we measure a new point in this very thin blue band, this classifier tells us that's map. There's, in this very thin band of feature space, there's this band of men, and to either side of that, people are always women. But actually, this is just one big space where we are more likely to see women than men. This is one more big space where we are more likely to see men than women. And the problem here is that we are judging the performance of our classifier on the training data. We are training a model. We are looking at how well it does classifying or predicting on the training data. And then we get these kinds of things, and we cannot distinguish between memorizing the training data or actually learning something about it. So what you do to judge your model is you test it, you test its performance on data that you haven't seen before. And you can go out and try and find some new data, but more likely you withhold some of your data. You split your data into training data and test data. You withhold this, and when you're done with your machine learning, when you've picked your model, you say, this is a good model. You check it on your test data, and then that determines whether or not you have a good model. And that's what makes machine learning so difficult, because you don't get to see the test data until you've chosen. So it's a crucial difficulty in machine learning. Other than that, it's still a very simple recipe, right? All you have to do is these four steps, and then you're done. This is what that looks like in code. This is the first worksheet. You'll be doing this. You may be doing this week. So we pick some features. That's up to you, depends on your problem, what you do, how you do this. This is a matrix, this is a vector. You pick some model, in this case a decision tree classifier. You make one, you fit it to the data, which is another word for searching for a model, fitting a model to your data, and then you're done. These two lines do everything I've been talking about so far. That's all you need to do. And then you check the predictions on your test data. So one question I will send you into the break with. We come back to the recommender system. This is one of our real-world problems that we have to abstract to a machine learning task in order to solve it. So my question for you, which we will come back to at the start of the second half, how would you abstract this into either regression or classification? Have a think about that, and we'll come back to that after break. So I sent you into the break with a little question. How would you translate the problem of recommending movies to a machine learning problem? Can we solve this problem with either classification or regression? Any ideas? What would our, for instance, well, both of them have instances. What would the instances be in this question, in this case? Any thoughts?
What movies people like for each person?
Okay, well, you're taking a few steps at the same time, but you're saying, what movies each person would like. So I'm right in saying that you would take person movie pairs as instances.
Yes.
Okay, that's very good already, because we're trying to judge something not about movies, not about people, but about people and movies together. So I have there as well.
You asked what were the features, and I would say the movies, whether they are light or not light, but you can show us the answer.
Although that's a good question. So what are the features for it? So our examples are pairs of movies and people. So what are their features? You were saying whether they're liked or not liked. I would say that's probably the target class. So that's the thing we're trying to predict. So we don't want that as a feature, we want that as a target.
Actors or genre?
Yes. So we have a lot of side information about the movies. We have a lot of side information about the people. Of course, actor is not really a proper feature. It's not really numerical categorical. But you can make it categorical. So you can, let's say, pick 100 actors and say for each, does George Clooney appear in this movie, yes or no? That's my feature, a binary feature. That works. So on the other hand? Yes, the year of release. So these are all features about movies we can do. We have features about people. What kind of features about people would help us predict whether or not somebody likes a particular movie?
Age,
yes, absolutely. So I mean, children's movies, adult movies.
The history of what that person already watched.
Okay, well, that's interesting. So here, the person in the back said the history of what that person already watched. So that's not the history of what they liked, because that's our target value, but the history of what they watched. So it's slightly different, but it's still the kind of thing they might like. Of course, it's difficult how to think how we're going to turn that into a feature, because if we have a history for a person with lots of movies they watched, all of those movies have lots of features. So that's difficult to turn into a feature. So our current class here is whether or not a person or a movie, whether that person would like the movie. Do you think this is classification or regression? Who would vote classification? A couple of people who would vote regression. Fewer people would vote regression. What would the classes be? I heard something.
I voted the other one, but it would probably be a movie that's going to be liked by the person seeing it. So I recommend a movie that they would like, and I recommend a movie that they wouldn't.
So you're saying two classes, like or don't like?
Yeah.
It's fair enough. Would probably work. In this case, Netflix and these days did star ratings with 5 stars. So you could have actually 5 classes or 6 classes. No stars, 1 star, 2 star, etc. 5 stars. Make it a little bit more fine-grained. But you could also do 0 to 5 or 0 to 1 as a numeric rating, and then it would become a regression problem. So both are fine. Both are applicable. The difficulty here is that you have a very, very imbalanced classification problem. So let's make it simple. Let's say it's classification, binary classification, person doesn't like or does like a movie. And what we have is a history of people clicking a like button, like on Facebook. In that case, we have a couple of likes, we may have 100,000 likes, but not nearly as many as the opposite. We have a huge amount of people, movie pairings, where there is no information, either they do like or don't like. And we have only a few likes and dislikes. At least, sorry, we have only a few likes compared to that. And the moral of this story, what this sort of turns into, once you start studying this, is that it's actually a problem that is not that... you're not doing the problem justice by modeling it, by abstracting it to either classification or regression. And you can get much deeper into the problem and you can get much better performance if you throw away this classification view or this regression view and you model it as what we now call a recommender system, which is a different setting, a different task. Then you don't have to deal in that sense with this class imbalance problem and things become much easier and much cleaner. So this is sort of the moral of the story. I showed you a very simple machine learning recipe. It makes machine learning very clean and crisp and very easy. And I would like you to keep that recipe in the back of your head, because that's the sort of level one of machine learning. But just remember that when you come up against a problem that doesn't quite solve, that doesn't quite resolve easily into a classification problem, or doesn't quite resolve easily into a regression problem, you can actually put these things aside and take all the little bits and things you learned from machine learning, all the stuff you learn about gradient descent, and you're going to learn about matrices and vectors and all these tools, you can apply them in a different way. So you're not stuck to this classification or regression thing, although it is a good sort of first approach. So where were we? We talked about classification and about regression. And the thing about classification and regression is that you have labeled examples. You have examples labeled with the thing you're trying to predict. And in that sense, they are supervised learning. Because you're supervising it, you're giving it examples of what you're trying, what you want it to do. And the opposite of that is unsupervised learning, or you don't have any labeled examples, and all you have is the data as is, and you're trying to get find some kind of useful structure in it. So it's a much more unspecified problem, it's much more difficult usually to evaluate, but it can be very useful because labeling data is very expensive, But getting a big bag of data is very cheap. The internet is full of petabytes of data. So unsupervised analysis is sometimes very useful, depending on your setting. I won't go too deeply into this, because in general, machine learning tends to deal more with supervised learning. But it's important to be aware of it. So we'll start with, we'll briefly discuss three different tasks in unsupervised learning. First off, clustering. Clustering looks a lot like classification. So we have features, data set with examples and features. You feed it to a learner. Learner produces the model. Model looks at a new example, and the model produces a class. Except that when we start, we don't provide the model with any example features, example target values. Sorry. We don't provide the model with example classes. We just provide it with the features. And in this feature space, the model or the learner has to decide for itself what the sort of natural classes or the natural clusters are. So we hope that things in the feature space tend to cluster together. We can assign these things a cluster. But there are no supervised examples telling it, this is what I want you to call this particular class. Here's an example of how that works, a very simple algorithm called k-means clustering. So we start with a data set. We have no labels. All we have is a cloud of points where we want to find some kind of clustering. We want to divide somehow this cloud of points into three clusters that make sense from the shape of the data. The way k-means works is it picks three mean points, which are supposed to be the central points, the mean points of each cluster. So we start out with three random choices. We just put three dots somewhere in this feature space. And then we label all the points. We color them by the mean point that they are closest to. You can see here, each point gets the color of the mean point that is closest by. And we throw away our first points, and we compute new means. And now we have a blue cloud, a green cloud, and a red cloud. And we simply compute the mean of each cloud, and those will become our new means. So here, we have three new mean points that are the means of our three new clouds. Then we throw away our old coloring, and we recolor all the points by the color of the nearest mean point, like we did before. We get new colors, we throw away the means again, and we compute new means from the new point clouds. And as you can see, the difference is a lot less big here than it was here. So we're sort of converging towards a stable value. We do the same thing again, throw away the means, recolor the points, throw away the means, recolor the points, until we stabilize, and we end up with something like this. Which is a reasonable clustering for this set of points.
How do you optimize for the amount of clusters?
The question is a very good question. How do you optimize for the amount of clusters? Or to put it more simply, how do you choose or search for the amount of clusters? The question is, at least in the case of k-means, you don't. You just pick one. Or you try a couple of values and you see how it works. There are good ways of searching for that as well, for incorporating that into your search, but not with k-means. You need a different clustering algorithm. So it depends on the clustering algorithm, I guess, is the answer to your question. That's all I'm going to say about clustering. Really just know that it exists and this is one way of doing it. Question, is this kind of like principal component analysis? I would say no. Not to put too fine a point on it, I think this is something different. I mean, all of these methods have a lot in common, so there is a way to relate the two, I'm sure. But in general, in what you're trying to do, I don't think this is like principal component analysis. For those of you thinking, what the hell are they talking about? Principal component analysis, we will discuss in a couple of weeks. So that's basically all I'm going to say about clustering. until a couple of patches later. Just know that it exists. This is how you do it. Another thing you could do is density estimation. And in density estimation, what you're trying to do is you're trying to look at your data, and given your bag of data, you're trying to get a judgment of which examples are more likely than other examples. So which kind of people, if I look at the height and the distance between shoulder blades, which kind of values am I likely to expect, and which kind of values am I unlikely to expect? Looks like this in the standard picture. So you create the learner from your data, again, unlabeled data, and your model provides you with a probability density, usually. It can also be a score or an unnormalized, but usually it's a probability density, which means that if you integrate this or sum this over all your examples, it should sum to one. So basically, to slightly abuse terminology, this just assigns a probability to each point, or to a space of points. This might look very confusing, but it's something you've probably seen before. If you've done any kind of statistics, like high school statistics, if you get a data set like this, these are last year's final grades, then most of you will know that this kind of shape, if you squint and if you don't look too much at the details, is called the normal distribution, and you can fit a normal distribution to this by computing the mean and the standard deviation. Then you get a normal distribution. And a normal distribution is a very simple, fitting a normal distribution is a very simple form of density estimation. It tells you that you're relatively unlikely to get a 2, which is good news. You're also relatively unlikely to get a 9, which is maybe less good news. And you're relatively likely to get a 6, which is good news, I guess. Of course, if you look closely, you see a few peaks, maybe by some kind of grading. And there's a peak here, around 3, which I can't really explain. So it might be better not to fit a single normal distribution, but to approximate this as the sum of 3 normal distributions. One with its peak here, one with its peak here, and one with its peak here. If you want to do that kind of fitting, things suddenly become a lot more difficult. It's a lot more difficult to fit the sum, the mixture of 3 distributions, than just a single distribution. That's something we're going to talk about. So that's density estimation. If your feature space is not quite as simple as this, if you have a complicated feature space, so think back to the digits examples, where we had 784 dimensional feature space. It's very difficult to fit something like a normal distribution on top of that. And these digits, they don't come from a very simple distribution, they come from a very complex distribution. So if you have a very complicated distribution like that, usually it's not very feasible to do something like density estimation. So you cannot get a probability density for a particular point. But what you can do is sample from that space, from your feature space. So you can sample a new thing, you look at your data, you get a cloud of points in this big feature space, big complicated feature space, or big high dimensional feature space. You get a cloud of points, you fit some model to it, and then you sample a new point from it that is likely according to your model. If the model that you fit corresponds a lot to the to the probability distribution that generated your data, then you will get very natural looking examples. What you're seeing here is similar to the digits. These examples were translated to a feature space just by making every pixel, in fact, making every pixel 3 features, how red the pixel is, how green the pixel is, and how blue the pixel is. Pictures are a bit bigger, so it's 3 times, I think 1,000 by 1,000, so it's about 3 million features for each example to describe an image like this. And what they did, this is a research by NVIDIA, what they did was they took a point cloud and they fit a certain model to it called a generative adversarial network, and then they sampled from that model. So they had a big bag of data with pictures of celebrities, and they sampled a new image of a celebrity. And this is the result of that. So these six people don't exist. They were invented by a model. And they weren't invented by a model that sort of models the face and does kind of texture mapping or places texture on top of it. The only thing that this model knew before it saw the data was basically what a picture is. It basically all it has is millions and millions of pictures of celebrities. It doesn't know what faces are, it doesn't know what eyes or noses are, it doesn't know what men and women are. It's learned all of that from the data. So that's quite impressive, I think you'll agree. Let me check the time. So that's the unsupervised models. Very briefly, I'd like to talk about machine learning as compared to other fields, other subjects. Try to go through this briefly. So first of all, how does machine learning relate to AI? I can be very quick here. It is a subfield of AI. Some of you are AI students, some of you are not. Basically, there are no things that are machine learning that are not AI, but there are things that are AI that are not machine learning. So most chess-playing programs don't actually learn. So they're a kind of AI, but not machine learning. Automated reasoning, planning, these things you can all do, and they all fall under AI. They are not machine learning in any way, because you don't learn from your experience. Data science is a phrase you may have heard a lot recently, which is the science of dealing with data in various kinds of ways. There again, machine learning is a subfield. So I think pretty much anything you do in machine learning, you are doing something with data, so it's always data science. But there are things you can do in data science, like gathering, harmonizing, or interpreting your data that are not strictly part of machine learning. But we are going to go into some of those, because if you want to set up a successful machine learning experiment, you do need to do these things. You do need to do data science. You do need to gather your data. So we'll talk about some of those things next week. More interesting is data mining versus machine learning. Who's heard the phrase data mining before? So data mining is a well-known phrase. How does it differ from machine learning? This is a very subtle distinction. And I had to think quite hard to come up with how to phrase this and how to summarize it. I would say that both of them are subjects that deal with taking some data, looking at it, and getting something out of it. But what you're getting out of it differs per field. So with machine learning, what you get out of it usually is a prediction model, whereas data mining usually focuses on getting out something about the data. And usually with data mining, what you're interested in is getting some kind of intelligence, some kind of business intelligence, some kind of actionable intelligence, a thing that you now know is true. Whereas with machine learning, what you're interested in getting out of it is a little machine that can tell you for a new email, is it spam or not? Whereas with data mining, you are interested in qualities of your big bag of emails, like the social network that comes out of it, or how it relates. So it's a fuzzy, difficult distinction, but they are different. Information retrieval and machine learning, it's a very simple distinction. Machine learning is, or information retrieval is about building search engines, so it's, in principle, has nothing to do with machine learning at all. But here it goes the other way. When you look at it closer, actually, it turns out that basic information retrieval is given a query and a bag of documents, trying to find documents that are relevant to that query. And you can map that you can abstract that to a classification problem. Again, one very unbalanced, like the recommender system. But still, this thought of thinking of it as a classification problem, or thinking of it as a regression problem, or a ranking problem, something we'll discuss later, it can actually be helpful in information retrieval and in redesigning your systems and making them work better or work differently. And actually, I would put something like recommender systems, what we saw earlier, I would put that in the intersection here as something very, something that really belongs to both fields. Here's another subtle one that I had to think about to figure out really what the distinction is between statistics and machine learning. Somebody came to me in the break and said, I've taken statistics and I understand everything you're saying, but it just has different, I just know different names for it. So that's one big difference between statistics and machine learning. We do exactly the same things, we just call it differently. Sorry about that, it's just the way it is. I think to distinguish them, I would say that statistics is more interested in finding out the truth about certain things. So if we do spam classification, usually in machine learning, we don't really care about how, whether or not our model accurately models the way an email is written. Most of our spam classification models kind of work on the assumption that emails are written by drawing words one by one independently out of a random bag of words, which is clearly not how we write emails. But under that assumption, we can write a very efficient email classification system that works very well. It's not true, it's not how we write emails, but it works, so we don't care. And a statistician would care. Statisticians care about whether or not their model is true. Machine learning people don't. That's how I would summarize it. Finally, deep learning. I think this is the first time I've mentioned deep learning. Who's heard the phrase deep learning before? About 50-50 maybe. Deep learning is something that's been in the news a lot, so you might be confused about what's the difference between deep learning and machine learning, because they get used interchangeably. I can be very quick. It's a subfield. It's a particular way of approaching the problems of machine learning, but it's a very exciting and very special way of approaching the problems of machine learning. And we are going to devote at least two lectures to the topic of deep learning somewhere down the line. So that's all for bounding the definition of machine learning. Let's finally try and answer. Just a little summary to properly close up the subject. This is what we talked about. We talked about abstracting problems to choosing instances, features, and a target function. We discussed supervised learning, like classification and regressions, with examples like linear, tree, and nearest neighbor models. Unsupervised learning, we discussed what loss functions are. It's an important thing to remember. A loss function maps your choice of a model to a number that tells you how well you did. And we discussed overfitting and splitting your data into testing training data. So we have about 15 minutes left to tell you how the course is going to work, what you're going to do hopefully, and what I'm going to do. So let's start at with the conclusion, start at the back. You're going to get a grade, and it's going to consist of these two things, each weighted equally in the end product. You do an exam, which is like most of the exams that you're familiar with, and you do a project. That's the only thing you will get a grade for. There will be homework exercises, but they will not be graded. There will be worksheets, but they will not be graded. If you want to get a good grade, this is what you have to grade them. Standard minimum grade for your exam is 5.5. The exam is about the lectures and book. As you can see, I'm recording all the lectures, so they will be placed online, probably on YouTube. You'll be able to rewatch them. I will also put the slides online. They're annotated with everything I say, so if you rather read than watch, you can also look the slides. You can also do both at the same time. And there's a book. More about that later. The exam will be multiple choice, because there are 300 people, so I can't really do it any other way. And there will be 7 homework sessions to prepare you for the difficult parts of the exam. So there will be, it's multiple choice, but make no mistake, there will be difficult questions where you have to do something complicated. And we will prepare you for those in homework sessions, where you get some homework, you do the homework, and then we talk about the answers. in about 2 hours. Attendance is only obligatory at project sessions. So if you think, I don't care, I'm not going to go to the homework sessions, I don't care, I'm not going to go to the lectures, that's all fine. Just make sure that at least one person in your group is at the project sessions. Minimum grade for the project is 4.5, groups of 5. Self-registration, so in Canvas you can register for a group. Please try and do that about this week. I mean, there's no hard deadline, but by the end of this week you should have figured out who your group members are. The choice of subject is free. There are some suggestions on Canvas. The sort of lowest level, if you want to take it easy, if you don't want to be too ambitious, then make sure that you do something that will be accepted, is to find a machine learning problem. There's a big website called Kaggle where they have lots of machine learning problems that you can try and solve. It's kind of a contest, so you can try and solve it and they will see who solves it the best. You can pick one of those and do a proper analysis on that, try a couple of machine learning algorithms on that, do a proper analysis of which one is better. That's sort of level one for the project. The rest of it you can find on Canvas. And every 2 weeks, starting next week, there will be a project session where you, in this project session, 6 groups come together and you will present what you've done so far. And this will be an informal presentation. So the idea is not that you prepare very hard and you try and outdo each other. The idea is just that you tell each other about what you've been doing for the past 2 weeks and you just show some nice plots. So if you've been looking at some data, you show a nice plot of the data. If you've been trying some machine learning algorithms, you show what they've been doing. If you've been fighting bugs for 2 weeks, which happens, if you haven't been able to get Python to run, then you present that. Then you just present everything you've tried and maybe people in the room can help you out. So it's informal, don't worry too much, but you do have to be there, or at least one person has to be there. And it's like a zipper, so half of you will start next week, half of you will start the week after, depending on which group you schedule. And you will do 3 of these project sessions throughout the course. This is the book. A little caveat here. This is a very good book, it's quite nice, it's very simple, it explains things very well. The drawback is that it's from 2012. So if you look at the book, this big subject I talked about earlier, this massive newsworthy subject of deep learning, is only mentioned on the last page. And that's not because Peter Flack wasn't paying attention to the news. That's because in 2012, deep learning didn't really exist yet. So in the last 6 years, since this book came out, a lot has happened in machine learning. And I need to tell you about that. Which means that for a large part, the lectures and the book are going to diverge. And you will have to read the book on your own. I can't sort of walk you through the book and tell you about all these new subjects. So my apologies, but that's the only way I can do it. Because all machine learning books are from 2012, so there's not really any other option. A little bit more about the exam, like the book. There are 3 categories of questions. Recall, where you simply have to remember something I said here, or remember something from the book. If you answer correctly, you get a point. Applied knowledge, where you have to recall something that I said here, or recall something from the book, and then apply it in some way. Use it, but not really in a complicated way. Just make sure you don't just remember it, but also you understand it. And then there's active knowledge, where you actually have to compute something or calculate something and get the right answer. These are the difficult questions, the ones that your homework sessions will prepare you for. You're not allowed to bring your book, of course, to the exam, but because there's no real reason to memorize formulas, we will provide you a cheat sheet containing the most common formulas that you will need to answer your questions. And this cheat sheet will contain a small blank space where you are allowed to write anything else you might want to write by hand. No printing it out. You have to write it by hand in pen, but otherwise you can make a little cheat sheet for yourself. Because it's not about memorizing, it's about understanding, right? Practice examples should soon come online, so you can see more about what this is like. The project has two deadlines. One at the end, of course, where you have to hand in a report. One at on March 1st, where you have to pick your subject. So until March 1st, you're exploring. We made some worksheets for the Python stack. If you don't want to use Python, you can use something else, but then you're on your own. And you can just explore and try stuff and try and do the worksheets and try and modify them a little bit, see what happens. Then on March 1, you have to, March 1st, you have to pick your topic. And then from March until the end of the course, you are doing your experiments and writing your report. Like I said, project sessions, they're interlaced, and they are informal presentations. Remember to discuss early on what kind of projects you're considering, what kind of subjects you're considering, so the TA can help guide you a little bit, and the TA can tell you that's too ambitious, that's not ambitious enough. Just realized I forgot to include the slide of who the TAs are. My apologies to the TAs. Their names are on campus, so you will find out. I think you've been doing a lot of group work over the past 3 years, most of your third years. But I'd still like to warn you a little bit about group dynamics, because there are 60 groups, and if half of you get into a fight, then I can't manage all of it. So please think about these things early to avoid friction within your group. So here are a couple of tips, basically. Don't do this. Don't say, well, we figure out five things that need to be done. We divide this between the five people in the group. Then we never meet again. And then at the end, we will submit when all those five things are done. Because basically, you think you will think you agree about what about the assignments you've made to each other. You think you're all on the same page, but you won't. And one person won't do their thing, and then it won't fit together again, or you get five things that don't fit together. Basically, this never works. You need to meet often in order to have a successful project. This is important. We have a very diverse, very big and very diverse group. Lots of people from lots of different backgrounds with lots of different skill sets. So some people will be a bit in awe of stuff like calculus and linear algebra and will have some difficulty with that. And they will want to reduce the level of ambition in the project. And some people will be very excited, you know, finally doing deep learning and exciting stuff, sampling celebrity stuff like that. And they will be very ambitious. If you have ambitious and non-ambitious people in the same project, that can go wrong very quickly. And if you come to me at the end of the project and say, well, I'm in this group with lots of people, we decided on this subject early on, and these three or four people, they just didn't do their work, I am probably going to assume that you're the ambitious person and they're not the ambitious people, and you drag them into a wild, ambitious project and kind of ruin their motivation. So if you want to avoid that, you need to discuss the level of ambition you're going for. You need to be on the same page with that. And in order to converge slowly to something you agree on, you need to not pick your topic right away. This is why we want your topic halfway through the course and not this week, because we want you to explore, we want you to figure out what machine learning actually is and how difficult you find it. And if some of you find it more difficult than others, we want them to catch up. And then we want you to pick it up. Some more time. Make sure you're on the same page. There's never been a project where everybody did exactly the same amount of work, so don't worry too much about that. And I recommend there are three worksheets, like I said, where you sort of get the basics. We tell you about the four worksheets, sorry, where we sort of tell you about the basics of this machine learning stack in Python. I would recommend you do them individually. So you each do them, and then you're on the same page, and you have a common vocabulary about what you're talking about. You all have roughly the same skills. So that's me being preachy about group dynamics. Finally, if you have a question, click this button and read the whole thing. From that laughter, I assume that you know what I'm talking about, so I'll make no more am I out of time. I have 5 minutes left. There's a lot of people standing up. I am not done yet. But I'll try and make it quick. I guess you're tired and you want to go somewhere else. I just want to talk, I briefly want to show you what we're going to talk about. So next week, week two, we are going to talk about method, how to deal with this overfitting stuff, and once you've chosen your model, how do you test on the test set whether or not it's a good model, and then how do you do multiple experiments to pick your best model. It's very difficult, and basically if you imagine yourself as surgeons in training, this is the lecture where I tell you to wash your hands. This is a slightly boring lecture, but I tell you about the things you really have to do and you really have to know how to do in order to be proper machine learning people and not to kill your patient. Linear models, we've seen some linear models already. We're going to dive into them. These weak numbers are wrong. We're going to dive into them Thursday. And we'll come back to them in week four. And I'm going to use them to illustrate the principles of searching for your model, which is a very important subject that comes back for all models, basically. We talk about probability. Probability, I think of as something that is not necessary for machine learning, but it is very useful. So you can do machine learning entirely without probability, but some of the best models we have, including the celebrity sampling one, are probabilistic in nature. Keynote also thinks I'm done. Deep learning, the big new exciting topic that we're going to talk about. I won't spoil too much. There's also ensemble learning, which is the basic idea that if you create lots of models and slight variations of your data, and then try and combine them somehow, you can actually boost your performance a lot. You can take really crappy models that have terrible classifying performance of just about 55%, if you combine enough of them, you still get a really, really good model. So it's quite interesting. That's what we call ensemble learning. Sequential data, like text. Obviously, if you have text, you can use the email trick and just measure features from your text, like how much does each word occur. But you can also design a model that can consume text natively. And what you're actually looking at here is a neural network that has seen Shakespeare, the entire corpus of Shakespeare, and this text was sampled from it, including the markup, including the fact that this says second senator and ends with a colon. All of that was sampled. Like the celebrity faces, we didn't tell it anything about grammar, anything about style. We just gave it the characters. We just gave it a stream of characters, trained it for a day, and I say we, somebody else did this, but. And this is what came out. So learn to talk like Shakespeare purely by looking at the text. And reinforcement learning, we have a little video. I'm going to skip the video. Basically, reinforcement learning is about the agent thing that I started off with when I said, that's what we're not going to do. We're going to do offline learning. Sometimes you do want to do the agent thing, and you do want an agent that learns and updates continuously in the world. That's what reinforcement learning is for. Finally, the second to last slide. This is what I want you to do this week. Make sure you register for a workgroup, make sure you get a group together, have a look at the first worksheet, and remember the first homework is due, well not due, but the first homework session is on Wednesday or Thursday, depending on which workgroup you sign up for. So you should get busy with that. What the worksheet looks like. This is what the first homework looks like. If this kind of notation scares you, then make sure that you are at the homework session. This is basically the first homework is there to give you a litmus test of whether you are up to date with the preliminaries, whether you are shocked by the preliminaries. So if you think, well, this is easy, I've seen this million times before, then you're good. If not, Don't worry too much, but make sure you show up to the homework session so you know what to expect. And with that, have fun with worksheets. Send me an email if you have any questions, but you can also put your questions on Blackboard. Thank you very much.